need no despair. For all these things are accomplished by diligence and labor. With this, we welcome you all to our 16th VCM on the topic financial due diligence by our today's speaker, CA Priyesh Karyaji. Good morning, sir, and welcome to our study circle. Before moving to core part of VCM, I request CA Ritu Agarwal ji, convener madam, to please address our members.
Good morning, members. Our today's topic is of immense importance. Being the arena where corporate acquisitions, mergers, takeovers have become a part of business strategy to grow rapidly and widely, due diligence is used to investigate and evaluate a business opportunity. So today, we would have glimpse of same and would have help our members understand and fundamental concepts of due diligence and sharpen their skill sets in this area. I would also take the opportunity to welcome our speaker, CA Priyesh Karyaji. Thank you, sir, for being here with us on this Sunday morning. And I would like to take the opportunity to introduce our today's speaker. CA Priyesh Karya is a commerce graduate from NM College and chartered accountant with 48th rank in India. He owes various degrees like FRM and CFA level 2. During his articleship, he have handled various audits like Development Credit Bank, Kimberly Clark, Indian Hotel Limited, NCC, JP Morgan, ILFS, PE Funds, ILFS, NBFC, etc. Played an instrumental role in IPO of Development Credit Bank. Presently, he is managing partner of Cumulative Ventures LLP and looking into fundraising activity for the startups and SME companies, also actively working with VC funds for carrying out due diligence of their investee companies, and have carried out due diligence for 30 plus years startups in last couple of years. With this, I request Priyesh ji to please take the charge.
Thanks a lot. Priyesh ji. Thanks a lot, Ritu. Thanks a lot, everyone, to invite me for this particular session. I hope I'm able to contribute a bit in enhancing everybody's understanding on financial due diligence. I'm sure everybody are here and from the fraternity and have tremendous amount of knowledge which they have gathered over a period of time. But I'll make sure, or I'll try my best to add a little bit, whatever little bit I can, to empower each one of you. And obviously during this period, I would also like to understand a couple of things more from you, and I'll try to make it an engaging session rather than a one-on-one session. I would request everybody to contribute, request everybody to ask me whatever questions they have in their mind during the process of this session itself. So it is much more interactive and helpful for everybody, and helpful for more helpful to me as well as a presenter. So with this, I would like to start this particular session. So Ritu said, so I have been having experience in the financial diligence space, but not only in financial diligence space. The advantage which I bring onto a table on any transaction or any assignment is the fact that I have experience across multiple domains, starting from audit to valuations to financial diligence to forensic to transaction. So that is the thing which I, that is the advantage which I get. Are you able to see the entire screen, or is it not possible for you to see?
No, it's good.
Let me do it a full screen mode. Yeah.
Now it's better.
Yeah. So I'm a partner at Cumulative Ventures. To begin with a quote, truth for us is simply a collective name for verification processes. This is a quote from William James, and which we use normally, or we use it during our analysis and everything. There are a few things which I use from our institute as well. The symbol for our institute is the eagle. So what it's give us is that somebody needs to have a 42,000 square foot view first before starting any transaction, and then deep dive into the details. So that is what we normally use it in our organization, and what any person who is working with me, this is something which I tell everybody to have a first don't deep dive into any transaction or don't deep dive into any assignment. First, have an overall view from 42,000 square feet and then get into the details. Otherwise, people get lost into the details. So, yeah, that is what I would begin with. So, you know, interestingly, so our topic for financial diligence, I've had 6 years of experience, 7 years of experience in this. And, you know, what is diligence? Like people say, okay, what is the diligence and what are the process which is followed and how different it is from audit? People normally, you know, see it is just an extension of a audit. And so that is where I try to come in and figure out a way to do something which is very different or which we don't get an opportunity to do in audit. So that is the kind of things which we want to do or we do in a financial diligence, which we normally don't have an opportunity to look at in the audit scenario. So obviously you first analyze the project, what is the transaction all about? So important thing is first to understand the transaction and the contours of the deal. So, you know, what are the deals or what are the cases in which you will have a financial diligence requirement, whether it's a mergers and acquisition or whether it's a joint venture or where there is an investment which is being made by a VC fund or a private equity fund or a corporate house, and they are acquiring a stake in a, you know, whether it's a startup company or it's a SME company or it's a very large company, right? So in all this you know, cases, there would be a need for a diligence. But so first is to analyze what is the project all about and what are the contours of the transaction. That becomes very, very critical portion. And then you start the process. So the process, you know, basically is you understand the company, you read about that company. First important thing is that you read about the business, what business they are into. Important part is to understand the business. In audit, normally we don't get that much into understanding of the business, but here understanding of the contours of the business, right from production, product to production, to marketing, to sales, all these functions are also, you know, understood. Whether we do a detailed analysis of all this function is a different story. But understanding of each section is very, very critical. Then obviously you do the documentation, you ask for documentation, you check the documentation. So the process involves, you know, collecting information at the very beginning. The important part is to keep a track of what all documents you need and then recalibrate and ask for more information. So for major part of the diligence goes into collecting the right set of information depending upon your preliminary review of the documents. And then you do the entire analysis of the business plan and everything. Then you do the analysis on the risk. What are the risk factors? So, you know, you do multiple analysis. Now, then you drill down into how much of this analysis is critical from a deal closure perspective or deal structure perspective and for the investor. So you do a risk analysis, you know, this is a moderate risk, this is a high risk, this is a low risk and all that. So all that risk analysis is also done. And then you finally give it a report then you do a ongoing monitoring, which is done after a deal if you are involved in the transaction or final close or to the extent of closure of the deal. Then there is an ongoing monitoring. And then you give it to the prospective investor or the partner or the acquirer, whoever it is. And important thing part over here is that it is very important that the findings which you have, the analysis which you have, it is also to be discussed with the target. A lot of time what happens is that a diligence is performed and the report or the findings are directly given to the acquirer or to the investor before even discussing the observations and everything with the management of the target. But it is very, very critical to do that because what happens is that we are not from business. We don't understand. We are not the business guys or we are not the guys who are on ground doing the business. So probably a lot of time what happens is certain things get missed out. Certain things, just a second. So a lot of things get missed out because there's a plethora of information you are working on. Sometimes our analysis goes wrong because of our lack of understanding everything. So it is very, very important to be nimble about our findings and observations and discuss those with the management without any bias coming in. The fact, you know, a lot of time we discuss with the management and the bias will flow on that, you know, the management has said this. Okay, we agree to it. So you have to make a balance without getting too biased by what the observation or what are the feedback of the management on the observation, and then you present the final report. So this is the overall process. I could say we'll come to that, but I'm a little bit jumping on between the slides, but I will go with the flow rather than with the slides. Any questions you guys have, or anything which you have, or if I'm just a second, huh? So if you have any questions, if I'm moving fast, do let me know so that I can slow down myself. So yeah, so what is diligence? Or what will I do is I will take this and this slides together. What is a diligence and what are the type of diligence together? What is a diligence? Whether it's a investigation, verification, or an audit of a potential deal or an investment opportunity. Normally, so this is a definition, right? And people go by this particular definition. Okay, we need to verify, we need to investigate, we need to do an audit. And the process which I follow within my organization is that diligence is an opportunity for my team to understand another business. That is what I go about. I don't go by you need to do an investigation, or whether you need to do audit, you need to verify, you need to check all this thing, you need to check whether payment of PF has been done on time or not, TDS collection, GST payments, and all this thing. Yeah, this is a part of it, right? This is a part of any audit assignment as well. But for my team, it's a learning process. It is a new understanding on a business, and that is what I tell my team to focus on more, rather than looking at what are the lacunas in the transaction, or what are the lacunas in the investing companies. That will be a part of the process, but it's not the entire process. So what are the points, or what are the key aspects which are looked at while doing an diligence, or what are the key, why a diligence is performed? So from an investor's perspective, there are a couple of things which an investor would want in any diligence process. Number one, the commitments, or the disclosures which are made by the investee company or the target company in their financials, or what they are claiming as their revenue or profitability and everything, whether it is true or not. That is the most important aspect. Whether the quality of earnings with which they're disclosing in the financials are real or non-real. How much of it is, one time and fluctuating? How much of these times have, going forward may not be there? So understanding of the earnings is the most critical aspect for any investor, because the investor is finally putting money for his money to multiply, right? To achieve the growth. If he's putting certain amount of capital or infusing certain amount of growth capital into a company, the idea is that this particular growth capital, which he's putting 20 crores, 40 crores, 50 crores, 1000 crores, whatever he's putting in the business, whether that will be able to increase the growth of the company or not. So for that particular assessment, he has only past to look at, whether that has happened in the past or not. If in the past the company has put in 20 crores and it has reached to a certain extent, then they can do a math of, if we pour in 1000 crores, what will be the expected growth in the company which will come. So important thing is to understand the earnings which the company has generated in the past. So for earnings, the quality of earnings, you will look at the sales, you will look at expenses, you will look at what is the working capital need, everything that will go into that. Sometimes also what happens is that, when a company's pitch to a VC fund or a private equity fund to invest in their company, they would give certain, financial model or, Excel sheet with projected numbers for a couple of years, 5 years, 10 years, depending upon the kind of business they are into. And then the financial model or the projections are basis. Certain assumptions. The assumptions are related to the revenue drivers, the cost drivers, and the capital need drivers. Then the assumptions which are there will flow from certain things. It will obviously flow from the past numbers. So they would want to assess that the assumptions which they have given while deriving the financial model on which the revenue is projected, or the profitability is projected, the basis, the assumptions are there, are whether those assumptions are supported by the historical actual numbers or not. So these are the key points or the key things which are there, which are very, very critical in the financial diligence. And it is important from the investor's perspective. Then the other things are definitely there, you know, like whether there are internal control system or not, whether there is a MIS system or not, whether the, there is a control system or there is a system to make sure that all the regulatory compliances are done properly or not, whether there are proper reconciliations or not. All those things are there, which is part and parcel of any audit process as well, that is gets reflected into a diligence process as well. But the key aspects are what I just said before. So that's the difference, I would say, between a kind of an audit and the diligence as well, where you overstep a little bit more in the diligence process, where you also not only see that, you know, this is the, so let's say, for example, there is an invoice and there is a profitability and you see that, you know, there is a revenue. What do you do in an audit is normally you check all the invoices and see that the revenue are supported by certain documents or not. In diligence, we go far behind and do analysis of the sales, that how much of the sales for which the invoices are there. There is a proper big backup and everything which is there. But in diligence, we see the quality of the revenue as well, that how frequently has the customer given you revenue. That is one thing which you see. Out of the customers which you have right now, how many customers contract has gone, or how, like, you know, if there is if in FY21 there is an X customer who is giving revenue, what has been the pattern in the earlier years for that particular customer, whether it has decreased over a period of time or it has increased over a period of time. The increase which is coming in the revenue from a certain customer, is it large enough or it is small enough? You know, all this analysis is done. And then to see that, you know, if there are certain customers which have come in this particular year, because of which the new customers have contributed a larger share of the revenue this year, then that new customers which have come in this year, they will be able to give a higher revenue in the coming years. So you understand the quality of the revenue. So that is what we go a little bit beyond audit and do the analysis, because in diligence process, what happens is you can say it's more that, you don't get more time. You get 4 to 6 weeks time. So the analysis plays a very larger role rather than the verification out here or investigation out here, because you have limited amount of time and in which you have to cover multiple years. Normally the period for which the diligence is covered is either 2 year or a 3 year period, depending upon how old the company is. So and you have lesser amount of time and you have to cover all the 3 years or 2 years and all the areas as well. So more of an analysis is done rather than verification, which is done. Any questions anyone has till now?
No, sir, please continue.
Okay, fine. So what are the kind of, you know, diligence which are normally, preferred, though we are looking at financial diligence only, but different kind of analysis are done from operational diligence to financial diligence, legal diligence, tax diligence, IT diligence, human resource diligence, regulatory diligences, environmental diligences as well. So different kind of diligence are happened, though we are covering only financial diligence. I will give you a brief, some small things on what each of the diligence could, cover. So legal and regulatory, I can club it too, though it can be different. I can club both the part together, because normally an entity which is doing a diligence on the legal front, they would do legal and regulatory diligence both. So legal is, you know, contracts, your contractual acts. You would refer to what are the different customer contracts which you have entered. If there are if it's a software company or if it's a online e-commerce company, then, you know, end user agreements which you enter into, all those things becomes very critical. The agreements with the promoters, the management team, the employment contracts, in software, the importance of non-compete is there, the importance of, trademark is there, or the intellectual property is much more. So you see all those areas in the legal diligence and everything. So that is there. Then the compliances will also come into the picture, whether ROC compliances and all those things will come, in the legal diligence. Regulatory diligence also would do more with the respect of regulators. If there are many industries which are controlled by regulators, like a fintech company in India would, you know, a couple of companies would be regulated within the SEBI, RBI domain and all those things. So the special focus has to be given on the compliances with the regulators, because that is a very, very critical risk which an investor has. If something happens, a new regulation comes in, or that there is a non-compliance with the regulatory requirements, the lot of time what happens is the startup companies which are there, they receive money or they receive investment in the early stage from multiple people and from multiple geographies. They would have a few friends, families abroad. They would be receiving money in India from them. So whether the compliance is related to RBI, issuance of share at certain price, all those compliances are done or not, that all would come into, you know, regulatory and legal compliances. Commercial diligence and operational diligence are a little bit go hand in hand, but more, you know, operational side is more on the operations. Commercials is the understanding of the pricing behind all the decisions which are made by the management. So that is what goes into commercial diligence, you know, how the pricing of the products are made, how the pricing of the raw materials are made, whether there is enough margin which is available or not, whether the unit economics of a product or unit economics of the service, whether it makes sense or not. All that comes into, you know, commercial diligence. Basically, you can see a part of costing which will become very, very critical out here. The pricing, then the cost allocation, all that things will come under commercial diligence. Operational diligence will be more on the manufacturing side, where the operations are hardcore on ground. You know, in that lot of things can be done. Like the technology has gone to such a far extent that we can, all the manufacturing process can be tracked through sensors and IoT and everything. So you could look at those particular aspect of how efficient we are in the operations or in the production process, whether our supply chain is IoT enabled, or the kind of services or the vendors which we are using, whether they are giving us operational data or not. You know, all these things become very, very critical. So to give you an example, you know, the kind of analytics which a platform like Zomato or Swiggy uses would be, you know, how frequently or how within the time the drivers or their delivery boys are able to deliver to a certain location. Okay, I stay in Mahavir Nagar in Kandivali. So whenever the order comes to my place, how much time is it is taking from which geography of the restaurants, and how we are efficient in doing that, and how much delivery at different location of a restaurant, how many deliveries they can do in a daily basis, depending upon where the orders are coming from. You know, all these things becomes very, very critical. So obviously there are analytical tools and companies who you know, take this particular data and give it to the management, based on which they do a lot of analysis, understanding, and based on which then their engineering team does the changes in the system and everything. So, you know, it's a very wide spectrum out there. IT, information technology diligence, is primary, you know, certain time what happens is this diligence is also done by a lot of large corporate houses. So let's say very large corporate houses are working with one of the vendors who is providing a technology solution to them, or banks, for example, a bank who wants to set up a new platform or who wants to use certain software within their existing core system, they would do a diligence on their vendors before onboarding them or before using their system within their entire framework of system. So IT diligence is, information technology diligence is done at that point of time. So the efficacy of the product, the software, all those things are done. Then the analysis is also done of the vendor, on whether the vendor has all the systems in place on the security side, on scalability side, everything. So all the diligence, whether those, so you know, developing a software also has certain rules. So whether the rules which are there within the IT framework, whether they had followed the systems or not while building the software or not, all those things are looked at. Then whether the software which is there, whether it includes any licensed, unlicensed software and everything also or not, all these things are there, which are looked at when information technology diligence is done. Human resource diligence specifically focus on employee compliances. large, you know, large manufacturing site who would have multiple geographies, employees, huge employee base, trade unions, whether the compliances of all the legal, all the, you know, human resources related compliances are done or not. Payment of bonus act, EPF, and all those stuff that will come under HR diligence. So what happens is that within the financial diligence, we actually look at part of legal. We look while performing financial diligence, depending upon who are who they are. So we normally go through all the contracts, we make the summaries, we do all those stuff. We look at certain portion of the regulatory compliances of ROC and everything as well. So bits and pieces are covered here and there. Similarly, for tax diligence, will focus more on the indirect tax and direct tax compliances. So even in the financial diligence, normally what people do is that when they appoint somebody, they tell the you know, diligence vendor to look at tax compliances as well. So yeah, these are the different types of diligences. Purpose of diligence, we elaborated you know, why a diligence is required. So the purpose is there. How it is useful is that that it helps the you know, the investor to make a decision whether it's a go in decision or no go. So basically whether to invest in a company or whether not to invest in the company and stay away from that particular company. These are the two things for which it is very, very critical. And identify what are the deal breakers. So what happens is that probably your diligence will throw 10, 15 observations on a company or the investment company. But as I said, we need to do a risk analysis, right? So how much of those are very, very critical and that will become a deal breaker. Basically, if these are the key risks which are there, then the investor will stay away from investing. So identifying the key deal breakers, a lot of investors would say, you know, a lot of, we have seen a lot of the investors who are not too much worry about the non-compliance on the GST front or, you know, tax front. If they are, so it's a startup company and a you know, they are raising and they are putting in 2-3 crores of investment or 5 crores of investment or 10 crores of investment. If the investment amount is not very small enough and the company has just started 2 years back, then the compliances and the small non-compliances on the tax tax perspective, on the direct tax, indirect tax, they would not feel it like a deal breaker because something which is there which can be rectified going forward. Identifying those deal breakers are very, very critical. So fraud, for example, if there is a fraud which has been committed by the promoter or something like that, if the revenue which they are disclosing is not, it is just 20-30% of it is fake and all those things, so then those becomes a very large deal breakers. Regulatory risk which is there, then it becomes a kind of a deal breaker where the regulatory approval is not there, the company didn't knew that those regulatory approval is required, and the risks are very, very high where you are working with SEBI or, you know, RBI and everything, then the risks are higher. So that can become a, you know, potential deal breaker. So identifying deal breaker is very, very critical. And, you know, this basically the diligence report then becomes a framework for them to negotiate on the deals which they have on the commercial, have already agreed with the company or the promoter. So what happens is like whenever the transaction is happening or the M&A transaction is happening or investment transaction happens, the commercials are already agreed and which is covered in a term sheet which is issued to the promoter. So, or the company. So the commercials are already agreed. So this, if there are findings are very much large, then this becomes a framework for them to renegotiate certain terms of investment with the target company. So this is what happens, and then it all, this particular diligence also becomes a part, and you know, for them to see in future whether the compliances are done or not, to put in process certain process if there are lacking, so they can use this as a you know, tool or as a base for them to make sure that they implement certain things which are given in the report for the company to comply. So yeah, this is also something which we already covered. When is a financial diligence required? M&A transaction, investment. Slump sale is also kind of a transaction only, but the mode of a transaction is different. It's basically a transfer of business at entirety to the acquirer. But the perspective is the same. Though little bit, there are small changes which will be done in case of looking at a particular transaction in case of slump sale rather than an investment. vendor diligence is something which is done by the promoter or the company, the target. So what happens is target, when they are going for a fundraise, they would want to prepare themselves beforehand, beforehand itself. So in that case, vendor diligence is there, so that the company or the promoter wants to prepare before going to an investor for raising capital. So his house is in order, basically. To make his house in order, that is when the vendor diligence is required. Yeah. Any questions till now? Anybody?
So there are no questions in the chat box.
Okay. Okay. Fine. So, you know, this is an process. This is an example of a diligence process in a joint venture partner. So what normally what happens is in a diligence process, that first is that a initial introduction happens. So let's say, for example, one JV partner is evaluating to consider a third party for a JV. So they will have an initial meeting with the JV partner and with the diligence team to understand and kickstart the process, introduction basically. Then we normally share a list of all the documents which are required. There will be a continuous process of finally, before which we receive the entire information, you would do a site visit, you look at this operation process like a normal audit stuff. You sit at their backyard, or you still sit at the company's backyard, wherever comfortable, and you review all the documents, discuss with the management team, understand. You basically have to, on a regular basis, keep asking queries to the management. They will start replying. You take entire feedback from them on all your observations, documented it. Final, you discuss that with, before giving the report to your client, you discuss it one more before finalizing the report, or before you are giving a go ahead on all the points. You discuss that and then you give the report to the your client. That is how the normal process which happens, and it would take anywhere between 4 to 6 weeks, depending upon the how large the transactions are. And also the team of your diligence team, which is there, that will also depend upon how large the transactions are. Larger the transaction and shorter the time, more the team you will allocate for doing the diligence. So, yeah. So what are the key questions which are normally put up in a, you know, or we need to ask ourselves, or our team needs to ask themselves, on what are the things which we need to evaluate? So as I rightly said, you know, the quality of earnings becomes very, very critical. So the top three questions, if you say, are related to earnings, and what is the drivers of the earnings which the company is claiming it to. Then what is the trend? So we do a lot of trend analysis of how the business has performed in the last couple of years, do all kind of trend analysis on the customers. We do a trend analysis on the customers. We do a trend analysis on revenue. We do a trend analysis on the profitability as well. So all these things are done. Then, you know, what is the investment, how strong the system is. If it's a software company, if it's an IT company, you would see how strong the, rather than a fixed asset base, you would see how the strong the employee base is. How many employees are there in the product team, in the R&D team, what is the churn within that particular team, how many people are leaving, how many people are joining, what is their background. All those things also becomes very critical in the new age, digital companies which we are seeing. So, and then you see the financial position on the balance sheet side, what is the leverage, what is the debt, how frequently we are increasing our leverage, and how the cash flow, whether the cash flows are there to support the leverage which is there or not. You also calculate a normalized working capital. A lot of time what happens in a manufacturing companies, to show that, or to raise capital from banks on a working capital side, you would try to, the company would try to inflate inventory, try to inflate debtors, and all those things happen. So you have to normalize all that things as well, once you identify that there is a problem or not, and then see whether the limits which you have taken, or the net working capital limit, or the CC limit which you have taken, whether it is able to suffice the working capital need of the organization or the company or not. You know, all these things are critical questions which are there, which needs to be answered. Yeah. So what are the typical diligence issues which we normally face. Just a second. Yeah, sorry. So what are the normal typical financial diligence or diligence issues which people come across? Customer concentration is very, very customer concentration, or you can say the revenue which is there, if it is coming from limited customers, whether there is a stability of customer base or not. So how frequently they are giving the revenue to the client? What is the repeat? So, in the digital ecosystem or in the digital companies, or you can say whether Uber or Ola or the, any e-shopping, e-commerce companies and everything, it is important that how frequently a consumer is using. Because what happens is that there is a cost for acquiring a customer. So Ola, Uber would spend good amount of money to acquire a customer. And then, then that particular customer will give a revenue or a profitability over a period of time. So that's why in the digital ecosystem or the digital companies, lifetime customer value, LTCV is what we call, becomes very, very critical. Because once they acquire a customer, the customer is not giving profitability on day one. They will because the cost is involved to acquire a customer. And then the customer will give a revenue and profitability to a company, to Uber, Ola, or any of such kind of companies over a period of time. So it's important for them if the base is that they have acquired a customer and that particular customer will give profit over a period of time. For that over a period of time, you need to see how frequently a customer, average customer, is coming back to that platform and using it. So that's the reason repeat customers is what we call, or repeat buying is what we call, becomes very, very critical in such kind of business. Swiggy, Zomato, Ola, Uber, or you name many of those. It becomes very, very critical. In a normal digital tech SaaS company, which is there, software as a service company, which is there also such things become very critical. If my cost of acquiring a customer is large and I'm going to recover that money over a period of time, then it is important that the customer continuously uses my platform for a couple of years, and then I will become profitable. Then there is a churn also which happens. Not everybody will continuously, work with you, or not everybody will be using your service on a regular basis. So what is the people who are churning, basically getting out of your system? That also becomes critical. So that particular ratio of churn rate, repeat rate, churn rate, all becomes very, very critical to analyze. So these are the main issue. This is the main issue within when you are looking at from a revenue stability perspective. Then obviously the internal control system, compliances with all the regulatory requirements, ROC requirements, which are there, whether the company has a company secretary or not, all the filings are on time or not, because the companies are, there are startup companies which are regularly raising capital, then whether the compliances with relation to preferential allotment has been complied or not, PAS 4 filing, PAS 5 filing, all these things are done or not, resolution, valuation reports, and all those things, that also becomes critical. Normal internal control related to purchase, employees, revenue booking, compliance with respect to the Indian accounting standard, all those things will become critical. Supply chain and manufacturing site inspection, more from a larger organizations who have a manufacturing site. So you do an inspection, you see how many employees are there, you would see the entire process which is there. Are there any bottlenecks within the process? So what happens in the manufacturing process, the bottlenecks which will be there, which will be in certain processes. One process, one particular machine can do a process 1,000 units per day, but another machine in the same manufacturing process would be able to only do 100. So, then there is a bottleneck which is there in certain manufacturing process rather than the entire manufacturing process. Then you evaluate why can't we increase the that particular process which is doing only 100 units per day. Is there a bottleneck in getting that particular machinery, or getting employees for that particular machinery, or the labor for that machinery? All those things are evaluated in a manufacturing setup. supply chain, again, a very critical aspect for an e-commerce company or a company which is into D2C brands, or you can say direct to consumer or consumer facing brands, right? In the food and beverages segment, supply chain becomes very, very critical. Where are they procuring raw material from? What is the lead time to get the raw material? Then if I'm into a distribution as well, I've manufactured the product and then I'm finally distributing it, then where do I have my logistics hubs, or where am I that I have a central hub where I'm first dispatching the my finished products, and then from there to all the distributors. So all those areas becomes very critical in evaluating. Because why it is important? Because the blockage of the working capital is there within the supply chain. So once you understand the supply chain, you will understand where the capital is getting blocked. So, you know, all these are areas to evaluate overstated EBITDA or EBITDA. So normally we do an EBITDA adjustment. So a reported EBITDA is where which is coming from the financials, and then we do certain adjustments to EBITDA to see what is the actual EBITDA, or not actual EBITDA, you could say future maintainable EBITDA or maintainable EBITDA which is there, or a EBITDA from a the transaction perspective, which is the true EBITDA which would be there going forward as well. So this I think unusual swings, basically some customers have come in a particular year, then they have moved out, you know, you do adjustment for that. A certain business is being stopped and only a new business is being continued. So from your revenue, you remove all the revenue for all the discontinued operations. You know, there is an accounting standard for that as well. So something similar to like that. Yes. So this is what kind of typical issues are there. Then working capital issues, regulatory matters we already discussed. Then management claims on growth. So basically here, uncertainty about targets, management claim on growth is basically also doing a diligence on the projections which the company has submitted to our client or the investor, and then they have claimed certain growth numbers. And that we do a verification with the past numbers and to see whether they were close enough to that actual numbers or not. So you do an analysis on the financial model or the projections and see vis-a-vis the base or the past base. So yeah, these are a few kind of issues or the typical diligence issues which you would face. So as we rightly said, right, important aspect is, what are the focus areas? We said quality of earnings, identifying unusual or non-recurring adjustments, significant. So I will show you over here in the next slide. This is the quality of earning, deep diving into quality earnings. This is the areas only on the financial diligence. Earlier, what we see was the entire of the diligence, but in the financial diligence, what are the key things which you would see? Quality of earning, unusual or non-recurring items, trends, operating and financial trends, analysis on the sales, operating margins, and all those things. The bridging operating period. So what do you mean by bridging operating period is basically, let's say you are doing a analysis over a period of 3 years, FY19, FY20, FY21. So what we do is basically there is an X revenue of 20 crores in FY19, 40 crores in FY20 and 100 crores in FY21. So the revenue has increased from 20 to 40 to 100. So we create a bridge, as in from the base of 20, what is the things which have added and reduced, which is culminating into a revenue of 40. And then from 40 to 100, what are the key parameters or the key numbers or the new customers added, additional revenue from new customers? What is that the numbers, how the numbers have increased from 40 to 100? We create a bridge so that an investor comes to know that which are the reason, what is the primary reason for the increase in the sales. The similar bridge we normally do for EBITDA as well, that what are the key reason because of which the EBITDA has increased from, let's say, 5 crore to 10 crore to 20 crore. Okay, whether it is cost saving, whether it is the additional margin or additional revenue, which are the expenses which have gone higher or come down, where the cost saving is done on an interest side or everything. So there is a bridge which is prepared over a for operating period, which gives a very a broad level understanding to any investor or to the acquirer of what has moved the mountain. Basically, that's what we do. Then you look at all the compliance with the Indian GAAP as well, whether revenue recognition is done properly or not, whether the capitalization is done properly or not. So in a startup company and in the you can say the digital companies, most of the capitalization is also becomes a very critical area. That what do you capitalize? Basically, they are building software, they are building products, and then still they continues to have engineering team which keep building new products, new features and everything. So how much to capitalize, what to capitalize, when you stop the capitalization, all those becomes a critical aspects. You then understanding on balance sheets, whether treatment of debt like items, regulatory frameworks and all those things, contingent liabilities, all those. So even in the SaaS company, for example, revenue recognition plays a very, very critical role, because what happens in SaaS software as a service companies is that they collect the revenue they collect the money from the customer in advance. Let's say it's a 1 year subscription. Normally people would say a 3 month subscription or a 6 month subscription or 1 year subscription, right? Like for Netflix or any other OTT platform, they collect the money in advance from the customers. Okay, and then what happens, because they will give you a chance, either you pay monthly, which will be larger than if you pay for a whole year or a 6 month period, right? So if they're collecting money in advance, then when to book the revenue, apportion the revenue over a period of the period for which the subscription has been taken. So this also becomes very, very critical. So there are a lot of such kind of companies right now in India. So important point is to do see that they are accruing the revenue properly or not. So this aspects becomes critical. So as I said, the quality of revenue or quality of earnings is the prima facie motive of understanding, a lot of things are based on the valuation of that particular entity is based on the quality of earning, right? Because that is what that is the reason why the investor is here to invest in the company. Not necessary that in every company you will have this particular issue. There are so many companies in India right now, in the early stage startup companies, you can say, where there are no revenue, so there is no question of earning as well. So maybe a year before this, you guys must have heard about this company called Cred, right? Which is a platform for you to pay your credit card bills and everything on your mobile. A year before, they were zero revenue. They had only expenses and everything. The only revenue which was there was the interest on their deposits, fixed deposits. So for them, this quality of earnings is no meaning from that analysis perspective. The analysis on basis of which they have the investor put in money is more on the user base, how frequently the user base are interacting, the number of transactions on their platform, how many transactions, let's say, for example, how many users are using their coins to purchase something on their platform, what is that percentage, whether they are doing it frequently or not, how frequently those people are doing or using this points to buy something or not, how frequently, whether there is in a last span of last one in a 1 year, let's say for example, since the day I started using Cred, in the 1 year period, how many times I have used my coins to buy something from them on their platform, And you do this analysis across, you arrive at an average, a median and everything, and you do this analysis across so many years for a user. So all those aspects become very, very critical while doing a diligence on them, because frankly, they don't have revenue. Though they have started generating revenue from this particular year, which I understand is that they have started to do a lot of cross selling of products. They have started lending money on their platform. They are lending money to basis the credit score the people are having, who are very diligent in paying their credit card bills and all. They have started lending money to them, so they are generating revenue out of that. So yeah, but before that they were not doing, right? So quality earning for them is it doesn't make sense. But yeah, company who are generating revenue, generating profitability, quality of earning becomes very, very critical. So, like I said, so in our company, in like, you know, we have certain clients whom for which we do diligence work. We help them in capital raise and everything. So one of our transactions which we are in recently involved into, they wanted to, the investor wanted to understand the per unit economics or per unit or per customer, how much revenue we are making on an average basis, and per customer, how much profitability which we are making. And that particular company also had different spectrum of customer. Customer one who is paying a subscription, customer two who is not paying a subscription, but still we are generating revenue from that particular customer. So in both these two different kind of customers, how much revenue we are per unit we are making from them. So that analysis we had done and given to them. So different industry, different businesses will have a different contours of calculating all and you know, understanding the quality of earnings. So you know, what is the main thing anybody would look at while analyzing the earning is EBITDA, earning before interest, tax and depreciation. People don't look at PAT, and because PAT is again because of the, you know, it gets because of tax and depreciation, they would not look at this. This is more, this gives more of an idea on what is the operating margin or operating profitability of the company. That's the reason EBITDA is looked at. And then you know, you use this particular analysis, you make a lot of adjustments, you know, that we will come to that, what kind of different adjustments are done to the reported EBITDA. But this is basically a base for a valuation as well. Lot of valuation for a company are based on earning multiples, whether it's a listed company or unlisted company. Earning multiples are there, which are used as a base for valuation. So understanding of qualitative earnings is very critical for arriving at the valuation. So what happens, a lot of time a deal structure is made in such a way that the valuation is dependent upon the EBITDA of the company. Let's say the investor has agreed that I'll give 10 times the EBITDA, okay, for current valuation. So in that particular aspect, the calculation of EBITDA becomes very, very critical. Sometimes what happens, the investors are putting money in a company, but the valuation is not fixed right now. The valuation is fixed, the valuation multiple is fixed based on a future EBITDA. Okay, let's say 3 years down the line, whatever the EBITDA will be of the company, on that a certain multiple will be given. In that particular case, understanding of real EBITDA also becomes today becomes very, very important. Let's say for the reported EBITDA is coming to 6 crores. But after all doing all the adjustment during our diligence process and everything, we come to know that the actual EBITDA is only 3 crores. Then it creates a big question mark on whether the projected EBITDA which the management had given, whether they will be able to achieve that or not. And on that, whether the multiple of 8 or 10 which the investor had agreed upon before starting the diligence process, whether that particular multiple becomes relevant or not. So it is very, very important to understand the quality of earnings. So part of the understanding of the business, it is important, but also important is from a deal structure or the valuation perspective, getting the quality of earnings or understanding the quality of earnings is very, very critical. So this is about this. So this is an example of, you know, a normalized EBITDA or a adjusted EBITDA, you can say. So this is from a recent transaction. Where it's a partnership firm, and they had reported certain EBITDA in their financials. Then we did all the adjustment. NQ, what you say, is basically a non-quantifiable adjustment. So we did an adjustment to certain aspects. So this EBITDA also takes into consideration a rental income which the company is generating. But in this particular transaction, the rental income will no more be available to the acquirer, because these are personal properties of the partners. So this income will not be available to the acquirer. So when you do an adjustment, you will have to ignore this particular rental income completely. And because we are doing an adjustment to EBITDA and not PAT, these are pre-tax. There is no adjustment for tax which is done on the rental income. Something with the company has been collecting money on cash, or, you know, because it's a partnership form, they would collect money in cash, and which is not booked as a revenue and all those things. similarly on the cash expenses side, certain properties which are there where going forward the acquirer will have to pay rent rather than receive rent. So the adjustments for such kind of adjustments are done. Partners remuneration which was not withdrawn in the current period FY21, we have made an adjustment for that. So if you see, it started with 193 lakhs as reported EBITDA, which is a growth from couple of years. If you see the adjusted EBITDA, it is a drop over here because this number which they had disclosed does not take into consideration the remuneration which normally they would have taken. Again, this remuneration which is there, it is an adjusted remuneration. So there is a calculation done for that as well in the behind. So if you see what here, there are notes which we give. And in each of the notes, and then we disclose in detail what is the kind of adjustment and what is the reason for doing such adjustment is put in. Then there are, you know, small other things like provision for gratuity, bonus, doubtful debts, personal expenses. The personal expenses which the company was claiming, the partners were claiming from the partnership firm, going forward they will not do because they are selling this business. So what will happen is then this will be added back to the profitability. So you need to do adjustments both on the negative side and the positive side both. Lot of time what I have seen is, you know, I've seen large CA firms or very large CA firms, they would try to see adjustment both only on the negative side. They would not show something which would be on the positive side, but it doesn't make sense. We have to be very fair to each party and be without any bias. We have to do our work. So adjustments, whether on the positive side or on the negative side, has to be should be disclosed. So such kind of adjustments are done. There can be so different companies or different different company, different assignments, different sectors, different industries would have a different kind of potential adjustments which could be here. So let's say, for example, if there would have been a one-time customer revenue and the profit which we would have earned, and now going forward that the customer is not going to come, so you know, you would reduce that profit from the current year profit to show that this is not a recurring profit on a regular basis. So such kind of adjustments are also done. Any questions you guys have?
There are no questions, sir.
Okay. Yeah. So quality of earnings, I think discussed in detail. But I can, so here it is just you showed the existing example from our assignment, but what are the key other things which you would look at is, you know, consistency of GAAP revenue recognition. As I told you, you know, recognition of revenue is very critical aspects in separate industries, whether on the manufacturing front or in the new age digital software as a service companies as well. So in that particular case, adjustments for revenue recognizing for OTT platform or any other SaaS based platforms becomes very, very critical. So we need to see that the revenue is recognized as per the accounting principles or not. If not, then you will have to make adjustments out here in the reported EBITDA. So in case if there is a adjustment you are making in the revenue, then we will have to show our adjusted revenue as well. So reported revenue, adjustments, and then the adjusted revenue as well. And then some similar kind of a table for we made for them. So then internal controls, management estimates or judgments. So sometimes what happens in that sometimes people also make adjustments for budgets as well, that what we had, the companies had budgeted and what the companies have actually made. So what people do is like they take that particular ratio of actual versus budgeted, and then they do adjustment to the projections, like adjusted projections they can make basis the divergence which have happened in the past 2-3 years. So that particular is taken as a base and applied on the projected numbers as well. Like say for it, if the budget was of 120 crores, we achieved only 100 crores. So there is a 16% on the projected numbers where the drop is. So they would make such kind of adjustment to the projected future numbers as well, and then see, okay, what is the probable revenue for the company and what is the probable EBITDA for the company based on the performance of the past. So they do such kind of we can do such kind of analysis as well. Then year-end accounting or reporting policies, revenue growth. So revenue growth assumptions. So for example, the revenue which they have looking at, how much of it is organic and acquired growth. So what does it mean is basically you do that the bump in the revenue which has come. Let's say for example, 10 or 20 crore to 40 crore to 100 crore. What which we discussed in the earlier example. How much of that 40 crore to 100 crores is because of our internal growth, and how much of because of some acquisition a company made and because of which the top line has increased. You know, all those kind of adjustments can be made in the this. So changes in revenue model, again, a critical aspect. So you change all this thing, then normalize run rate analysis. So what do you mean? What do we mean by run rate analysis? Run rate analysis is basically any company which will be growing, say for example, 40 crore to 100 crore, which the company has shown, could also be because of the fact that in the because of COVID, there will be certain sectors which would be doing pretty well. Let's say, for example, for 40 to 100 crore, there was a digital education company and they had a huge jump in that post-COVID scenario. So initial 4 or 5 years, there was a bumper jump in the subscription or the online education, and then it has tapered down. But still it is showing 100 crores. Then probably you can make an adjustment that now the trend, it is normalized. Now from the next year onwards, it will not be seeing the same growth which is there. So quarter on quarter growth or month on month growth, which we have seen from 40 crore to 100 crore. So it has increased and then it tapered down, or it has become, you know, stabilized. So the next year's projection will not have the same trajectory. It will be normalized only. So all those kind of adjustments or analysis can be done and given to the investor. So finally, what happens is, as a job, the job of the diligence team is to portray the facts, what is there. And then the investor or the company or the acquirer they will use their own senses to make their own analysis and project it to their client or discuss within the management team internally, because they would understand the business much better than us. So our job is to give as much as facts which is there, which is possible, for them to make the inferences which is required. So yeah, so many things are there. So quality of earnings are dependent on a lot of things. You see over here, you know, terms, discounts. So, you know, how much of the, revenue analysis is one thing. You do what is the top line analysis, which is there. But a lot of time you would see there are so many discounts which are given by e-commerce companies or such kind of digital companies. So the discount as a percentage of revenue would be increasing, would be very high. So if you are seeing a jump in certain quarters or certain months of revenue, but there would be a similar jump on the discounts which are being offered as well. So your analysis should also make a comparison that the revenue growth has been there, but it is at the expense of the huge amount of discounts which was being offered to the customers. You reduce the discount which is being offered to the customer, the top line will normalize again or it will decrease. So all those analysis are there, which is critical. Then you do the similar kind of analysis on the cost side and expense side as well. On the compensation side, you would do headcount analysis or bonuses and other payment. Headcount analysis is also very critical. So what we normally do in our headcount analysis or employee analysis is what we do. The different kind of analysis which we do is, attrition ratio. How many people are leaving year on year? How many new employees are getting added every year? Whether that addition in the employees is in relation to the growth which is there happening in the business or not. Then the quality of the attrition which is there, that how so there are 10 employees which have resigned during this year, but out of that 10 employees, 8 employees are somebody who have resigned or have been working with the company for last 3 years with us. Then it's a very bad story that 3 experienced people from our team has left the organization. Then the reason behind those resignation has been also becomes critical. So we take all this data, or you can say all this information from the company to do the analysis. Because reasons, if the reasons are non-performance or the reasons are, bad working culture, bad working environment, they had a better prospect somewhere else, this becomes a little bit issue. And the experienced people going is always a larger chunk. In the startup culture, in the new age digital companies, the attrition ratios are normally high. But that is because also because of the policy which they follow of hire and fire. Basically, you perform or you perish. That's the policy which a lot of digital companies or the startup companies follow, because they have a very limited period in which they have to grow, because they have received a growth capital from their investors. And the prima facie reason for them to receive this money at a, such a high valuation is that they have to achieve the growth very quickly. At one point of time, the promoters ask for a very high growth, high valuation for the companies. Then at the same time, they have to perform at a very, very thin line. So that's the reason they follow the same policy with their employees as well. Perform or perish. So in the early startup, the companies, a lot of people leave, but those are inexperienced people who are recently joined. They would not be able to succumb to the pressure which is there of working across so many hours and under stringent budget or your stringent targets. They would leave the organization very quickly. This particular aspect becomes very great. But the core team or the management team or the experienced people, if they are leaving the organization, then it becomes difficult. Then you also do an ESOP analysis as well, that how many employees have been given, what percentage, whether the ESOPs are offered according to performance or not, whether there are performance targets which are given for that people to be eligible for ESOPs or not. All these things become very critical. Okay, so we have drilled a lot on the quality of earnings, basically looking at how the on the earnings perspective, quality of earnings we have looked at. But similarly, we also look at just a second. We also look at working capital and cash flows. That also becomes critical aspects. Working capital becomes very important in the manufacturing space, trading company space, pharma. So anything related to manufacturing, working capital becomes very, very critical. Even the startup companies, working capital also becomes very critical. So I'll tell you how it becomes very critical. Zomato, let's say, for example, they collect a fee, the payments are made on their platform by the consumers, and then they pay the restaurant. So what normally happens is they pay their restaurant after 15 days, 20 days time as well. So till that point of time, that particular working capital or the float which is there, of revenue which is there, or the money which is there, it is used by Zomato or Swiggy and everybody. Similarly would be the case with Uber or Ola. They normally say that they make the payouts to all the people on a weekly basis or a couple of days basis and everything, but then they do different thing, use their this way differently. Like if the customer wants a 20% revenue share, then they will get the money after 20 days or 25 days. If the restaurants are paying 30% revenue share, then they will be paying on a weekly basis, something like that. So they use this all mechanism. So at that point of time, a lot of money which is there, which is available for Zomato. So profitability, they may not be profit positive, but probably they may be cash flow positive from a cash flow perspective, because they have huge amount of money which they are collecting on behalf. Obviously, they have to share it, but it generates a lot of liquidity for them. Similarly, was the case with Amazon. So Amazon took 7-8 years to become profitable, but the advantage they had is that they were always cash flow positive. For them to keep reinvesting in their businesses. Now is the fact that even their e-commerce platform is not that much profitable. But what is the cash flow or the cash generating machine for them is their cloud, Amazon Cloud, AWS, which they call Amazon Web Services. That is revenue, profit, and cash flow accretive. And all that gives them money or the capital to put money in the other businesses or the cash burning businesses. So yeah, you need to have certain businesses which keeps giving you cash so that you keep pumping in money in the riskier businesses. So working capital from that perspective also becomes critical. So you know, if there is another company, I'm sure you guys would have heard about this company called Bharat Pay. So this is a company, it's a payment gateway, or you can say using UPI, they enable merchants to receive money from the customers. So what they have entered, so normally what happens in UPI, there is a charge, a certain percentage or transaction, MDR is what we call, is a charge which everybody loses out on, because the payment, if the payments are from UPI, on a card there is an MDR and everything. In UPI there is a very small fee which is there. So what Bharat Pay does is he forgoes this money. He says the merchant will not have to bear this cost. They will pay to the merchant this particular fee, but they will receive the money after 25 days. You know, so all the customers are paying through Bharat Pay UPI to a merchant. They will not receive the money immediately. They will receive the money after 20 days time. So till that point of time, Bharat Pay is using that particular money to do different things. So they do lending. They do a 15-day lending for all the merchants and everything, and because of which they are earning much more money out there rather than on the MDR fees. So there also the working capital becomes very, very critical. Though in the normal, not in the normal sense as what we understand, you know, debtors plus inventory minus creditors, but there the working capital context is very different. But yeah, so yes, so working capital from a normal perspective, it becomes very, very critical. You like, you know, you do an analysis of you. So what we normally do is that we do a monthly analysis. We can do a monthly working capital analysis, collect all the information on debtors, creditors, inventory, and all this thing, and plot it and do a month on month analysis of how my working capital gap is increasing or decreasing. Then that we can compare it with sales as well, monthly sales as well, monthly collections as well. To understand whether the bumps which are coming in certain months is because if there were higher orders or higher sales which are there, or certain times what happens is though the sales is not there, so in project, turnkey project kind of a company, the sales may not be there, but you have to build up an inventory and data and inventory at least for a good amount of period, and then the delivery happens when the sales come in. But so the bump will be coming much before the sales, which is kicking in. So you do such kind of analysis to figure out that what during which period is that you would need a higher working capital support from the banks. Then you list this particular, you do this analysis and you compare it with our utilization as well. So what do I mean by utilization is a CC limit utilization. So normally what happens is every bank, every company would take a working capital limit, whether it's a CC limit or an LC limit, or you know, or FLC limit, anything, and that particular limit is a limit within which the company actually can borrow the money, and then against that you also plot the actual utilization of how much money actually the company has utilized out of that limit. So you understand that whether there is significant room available or not. Let's say for example, if the company is always been threading on the line and always using 90 to 95% of the limit, then if somebody, some large contracts come in, the company will not be able to take it. Why? Because you don't have the enough working capital room which is available for it to take a very large project. Then it's a steady line, steady business within which they will have to operate. If their limits are higher, they are taken higher limits and the utilization is on the lower. If you have a 25-30% gap or room which is always available for you, then if a large contract comes in, large business comes in, then at least you have the limits big enough for you to utilize those particular limit and grow your business. So this analysis is working capital management is also done. Then you obviously do the analysis on debtors days, payables days and everything. You figure out that why certain, debtors days are higher because of which kind of clientele, which kind of customer, is there a way to reduce those kind of, so we also do debtors days by customer as well. If the company is not large enough, small enough, you could day, not only debtors aging, but you can identify, you see the debtors days, you plot the debtors, you plot the sales and you calculate the debtors days for customers as well. Each customer as well. So you come to know which are the debtors who are not paying on time and what percentage of sales is that the debtors are outstanding for them, whether while pricing those particular debtors, whether the company had a policy of taking into consideration the period and building in the interest cost as well while pricing to that particular customer. All these things can be analyzed and discussed with the management. Seasonality of course plays a very large role in certain industries. Hotel industry has a seasonality, education industry has a sort of seasonality, different sectors have a different seasonality patterns. And pick and throw is basically the highest and the lowest of the point, so that will go along with the seasonality analysis. So yes, so this is normal adjustments, as I said, we normally do. Lot of things are there in this where I don't want to get into the detail, but we normally do that. This is the reported working capital after adjustment. What would be the adjusted working capital? All those analyses are done. So the adjustments are done to each and every components out here, whether it receivables or provisions for doubtful debt, certain things which are not covered over here, which should be part of the working capital as well. All those adjustments are done. Similarly, an adjustment is also done to a net debt. So what happens in the books also? So this is an analysis is done by a lot of big four companies as well, and large CA firm is there. Just a second. Where they do adjustments to debt. So reported debt is basically the debt which we have reported in our financials of long-term and short-term debt. And then they do adjustment to certain items. Like we don't call it as a debt, but are made additions are debt to the made. So there is a reason for that. Let's say, for example, over here, there is a statutory use payable, which is 4.3 lakhs or millions, whatever that is. Now, why it has been added to a debt is their understanding or their perspective is that if the company had to pay this statutory dues on time, they either would have put in their own money or they would have taken some loan from outside and paid this statutory dues. This is how they view it. So if they had to borrow money from outside and pay the statutory dues on time, which has not been paid, so the debt would have been higher, correct? Overdue employee costs. So COVID, because of COVID, they had hold on to certain employees and they had not paid them on time. So they made an adjustment saying, 5 crores is my debt, but if I had to pay all these employees on time, the company would have borrowed some money from outside and paid them on time. So, this is the kind of adjustments they do. Overdue creditors also, let's say they would calculate normal creditors is 60 days. They have, these are creditors outstanding for more than 60 days, they are not paid, so you add it to a debtors and all these things. So all these small adjustments are done to figure out that what would be their normal debt. However, what happens, this also is also so adjustment to net debt is not necessarily because not every transaction, the contours of the deal or the contours of the transactions which is not dependent on our debt component, then this adjustment doesn't make much sense. Though from a perspective of giving this knowledge to the investor or to the acquirer is very important and critical, from a deal structure points perspective, it may not be useful always. So yeah, this is till the adjustment. Any questions, guys, till now? I have another half an hour left, so I will make sure I cover the entire presentation. I hope I'm on time. Any guys, any questions?
Sir, there are no questions. You can proceed further.
Okay. Yeah. So I'll just look at what all things are important. Lot of things is pending. I'll try to move fast. So then I'll skip this. So this is basically, I'll just give over. This is basically you make an adjustment to operating cash flow. So what we prepare in a cash flow, you see like, on the cash flow from operations, you do certain adjustments to operating cash flow as well. This is all based on your adjustment to EBITDA and your adjustment to the net working capital. So that is based on which the, just a second. you make adjustment for the cash flows as well. So that's about it. Other things, what we do trend analysis. As we said, you do a trend analysis of sales, EBITDA, working capital, everything. Forecast, as I said, that we do analysis on the forecast as well, whether the assumptions which are behind the forecast or the assumptions underlying those forecasts, we do analysis on that as well. And other qualitative stuff on the internal control system, information management system, management reporting, all those things are there or not. I'm just seeing a chat which is... So this is an example of a trend analysis. So if you see, this is a revenue, the trend analysis of revenue. A dip has come in this this two quarters. We say that why the decline has come. There is a revenue which jump which has happened in this particular quarter. So what is the reason for that? If there are certain adjustments which are missing, you just make out and call out that why this. What are the reason for this lower amount? You do a analysis of different categories. So this is a total revenue analysis, and then you do an analysis breakup of the quarter on quarter by different categories of revenue. So this is basically of an eye care. This is a revenue analysis on the eye care company. Kind of different surgeries which were prepared. So if the drop which you see over here is drastically because the drop in the cataract surgeries. Now, obviously, the cataract services dropped down in quarter one because there was a severe lockdown which was imposed again, right? So that dropped the business. And then once it opened up, it recovered. So because the data is available only for 2 years over here, you could have gone past of it to actually see pre-COVID also what was the case. But the data was not available. Or otherwise, you could have done a pre-COVID, 2 year pre-COVID analysis to see what has been the growth in the or the quarter on quarter numbers. So now I'll go to key findings or the experience which we have had. So obviously this is also part of experience what we had in our assignments. So this was a travel focused digital lending platform. So when I mean by travel focus is basically they used to lend to the consumers whoever wanted to travel for leisure. You know, if I'm taking a trip to Hong Kong or Dubai or Europe and my budget is 2 lakh rupees or 3 lakh rupees, I could take a loan from this company and plan my trip to Europe and everything. So that was this particular company. So we broke down. So they also used to get the leads from different partners. So they used to get leads from the travel agents. So we bifurcated that partners into different regions. What is the total kind of number of partners in each particular regions? The lead generating, basically the partners in the central region, they gave 40, there were 40 partners who gave a lead of 17, they generated only 17 leads. And what was the lead conversion? So this basically gave us an idea of where the majority of the presence of the partners are, from whom they generate the leads, how efficient they are. Basically, this is the efficiency ratio, lead generator, that 17 out of 40, a percentage, all those things. So you get a ratio of doing an analysis of how in different in the regions what is the lead generating ratios out there, lead conversion ratios according to different regions. So you could see that the majority of the leads being generated by these companies are on the eastern and the northern region, like that. Then you see a lead generation to lead conversion to generation ratio, this particular ratio. So you understand that the conversions are more on the higher on the eastern partners rather than on the other regions and everything. So you discuss all this. So you find out all this analysis. This is also done on a monthly basis. So this is an overall analysis which we did. So you do a monthly analysis also. All those things can be done. And then you figure out that 50. So if you see that lead generating guys are 291 out of 598. So 50%, roughly 50% of the partners are enrolled. So 50% of the registered partners are active. How only 12% of the registered partners being actual business to the company. So then this particular ratio which we have arrived at 12%, that becomes very, very critical for in the financial model to see the project numbers which they have taken, whether they have taken this consideration of this or not, that finally the business, like basically 70 out of 70 divided by 600 roughly will give you 12%, right? So 12% of the leads will be generated out of the partner. So whether this particular ratio is considered while building the financial model or the projections or not. Then 24% of the lead generating partners convert leads into customer, you know, which is coming from this particular number. So all these things are very, very critical. Conversion in instant and center is lower. So all these things becomes very critical when you are building a model or also to giving it to the investor. See, investor also is not in this particular business. They have understood the business from the promoters or from the companies, but they are not going to run the business. But they also should have an essence of what the kind of business is that they are getting into. So from their perspective of evaluation going forward as well, and talking to the company as well, it becomes very important to understand the nuances of the business. So this becomes very, very critical for the investors as well. Similar, so the same company, if you see the year we had done a conversion ratio analysis, here we did a lead. So this is a basically a through funnel that how many leads were received, how many leads generated, not generated. Basically, this never got generated, converted into leads. Then the only potential leads were this much. Then how many leads are available for conversion, and then leads rejected and leads converted. So all this analysis is done on a monthly basis to figure out that, you know, month on month increase, month on month conversion, lead rejection ratio, lead conversion ratio. So if you see the lead rejection ratio over here, it is reducing from 77% to 59%, which is a positive sign. Lead conversion ratio, though, has been remaining at around 10 to 11% only. It has remained near about the same. It has increased certain years, it has decreased certain months. But the overall till December 19, from April 19, in that 9 months, the ratio is almost near about the same, though the rejection ratios have come down. So, you know, all this analysis again becomes critical from a investor perspective, understanding the business. See, this is nothing related to the quality of earnings and anything at all, right? This is more the analysis on the upper side, on the revenue side, the quality of revenue side. This becomes very, very critical. And if you see here, the year on year numbers are also there. In the whole year of FY19, 473 leads were there. In next year, they received 4,900 leads. So a 10% jump in the lead received ratio. Because this was the initial year, they had just started a platform and everything. That's the reason the numbers are low. Here, the lead conversions are 34, but on a year-on-year basis, the lead conversion is 253. So again, a 90%, you know, 9 times jump roughly out here, 8-9 times jump over here. So this kind of analysis is done on the revenue side. Again, same for a travel digital lending platform only. So what we understood, you know, this is the kind of different metrics which we had building, where we had said the, if you see over here, it's what we normally called as a kind of a cohort, but this is not like a cohort analysis. Similar to that, here is a lead date, as in lead date, and then here is a travel period. So normally in a travel industry, what happens is that the lead is generated in a month, but the travel period could be different. Okay, so what I mean by this particular, let's say, for example, lead May, I'm saying. So the in May 2019, the leads which were generated are this total. The total leads generated were 250 plus 270 plus 58 plus 70. This are the total leads generated in the month of May 19. But the travel period was 250 in May itself, 270 in June itself, July 58, 27, like that. Because the lead was generated in May 19, but those out of that people, 270 were planning to take a trip in June, 58 were planning to take a trip in July, and August 27 were planning to this. This analysis was done to understand that how much earlier is that you get the lead, start getting the lead. And the important thing then is to, so that in May itself, we got so much of lead. The important thing is to convert those leads. That is very, very good. So this is an analysis only of the lead, but the conversion ratio is very high. So the prospective clients, the travel companies get very early, and then they plan their trip. So important things. So travel period of your, if you see, the majority of the travels are in the month of May, June, July, because this is a, you know, vacation period. So majority of the trips will come in this particular period, but the leads will start coming in. But in this particular period, if you see May and June, majority of the inquiries and the travel happens in this particular month. So people who are going on vacation, their lead to travel period is very fast compared to the period of September, October, which is kind of near to the Diwali's and the second period, which is there. There the inquiries can start before as well. So, you know, this is the kind of analysis we had done, more so for people to to the investor to understand how this industry is working and how the analysis has to be done. And important is to that, as soon as you get a lead, you convert that lead into a conversion. So the advantage of this particular is that you get a lead very quickly and you get good amount of time to convert that. Normally what happens in a lot of other business, a lead is generated, you have to immediately convert that. Otherwise the customer is gone. But here you have an opportunity because this period, let's say an inquiry is coming in the month of April, is going to travel in August. So you have good amount of 3 months time to make sure that the lead is converted and he finally becomes a customer in August when he's traveling. So you have good amount of time there to convert that lead. So yeah, different aspects of business which are thrown out of this particular table. This is for a digital lock company. Basically, they are a company like, you know, like we have a lock of Godrej and other companies. This is a company also with a lock, manufacturing locks, but they have a digital system. Basically, you can unlock it with your mobile phone and putting a number and all those things. So it's a digital lock company based out of India as well, the India only. So we had done an analysis on the, you know, quantity, amount, average realization on a year-on-year basis, revenue, month, and then you purchase, you see the margins. So you see the, so because they used to basically import a lot of this digital lock. So what they used to do is they used to import the lock, manufactured lock from China or other geographies, and then they used to put their embed their software into it and then make a digital lock. So purchase and what is the, you know, amount and the margins, so purchase costing and then the roughly what is the margin. So you could do a analysis on revenue, margin and the products and do a contribution analysis as well. You know that 15%, 50% of the quantity sale, which is related to fingerprint lock, but they only contribute 26% and 8% of your margin. So, you know, so they have only 8% margin. The contribution in their margin, hence, is only 15%. So out of the total contribution, or you say 36, out of this 36, 3 lakh or 3 million, whatever that number is because of this particular product. But quantity-wise, it is 50%. But in the total contribution, its share is only 15%, right? So, but this will also make sure that your majority of the capital is blocked in over here. So a majority of the capital is blocked in a product, which is fingerprint lock, but it's so 50% of your working capital will be blocked over here, but the contribution margin will only be 15%. So, you know, this kind of analysis, which will be thrown in by such kind of numbers. Similarly for same, I will skip this particular thing. So here we had done customer, rental. So different categories of sales as well, hardware sales and rental. So they used to do rental. They used to take digital lock and give it on rental basis as well, rather than selling it outright. So analysis on that particular part as well. So now what I'll do is, I have 20 minutes left only. So now we will cover certain, startups which have been there and what were the failures, or you could say what was the issue with them. So Food Panda is one company which was got acquired by Ola. So the critical aspects of their diligence finding was the, you know, what is the kind of edge. So Food Panda was into like a Swiggy, Zomato and all. So what was the edge for the over the competitors? None. They were like two behind those competitors. Fake restaurants and orders. So the diligence throughout that, you know, a lot of fake restaurants were there through which they were showing a lot of billing and a lot of orders which we were doing to the fake customers. They are showing. So this is a finding of, this is a very, very major finding of this. As I told you, it's like a deal breaker. So, you know, unstructured business model, you know, in delivery, you need a supply chain, strong supply chain as well. So that faulty strategy of to meet evolving demands, basically, you know, the demand is there, but the strategy they had adopted is giving, you know, they had come with certain schemes like you order this and you will get it 100 rupees, you will get 9 chocolates or 9 chocolate ice cream free and all those things to acquire customers. So the strategy, the demand was still there, but the strategy which they adopted for acquiring customers, it gave a huge jump in their revenue for a certain period, and then it fell down drastically. So, you know, different strong strategies. This is one thing. This is a China-based bicycle sharing company. You know, what are the problems which they had? Bad quality product. Basically, the product was wrong. In India also, we saw this one company recently. An article came on Money Control, which talked about a dog parenting company, basically. So there was this company in which they were early stage investors. And then when there were large VC firms who were ready to invest, they walked out of the deal after doing the diligence. They themselves did a diligence where, you know, normally a lot of people will have a pet at their home. And managing a pet dog or anything is very, very difficult. So there is this company who used to help them, help the such kind of families to do a parenting for the dogs or their pets, other pets. They would take you, they take the pet to roam around for all their early morning rituals, which are there. When they are not there at home, they would, it's like a rent a parent for a dog. It's like that concept. When they did the diligence, they figure out that, you know, there were a lot of such dog parenters in a ground or in the colony and everything, large colony and everything, but they were all hired, basically. It was not to show that there was actual demand. They were being hired by people to just walk in the park, walk in the ground to show that there's a huge demand out there for their particular product. So they did all these things to fudge the numbers, to show revenue and show the traction and everything, which finally the investors caught and they walked out of the deal. And now they are fighting a legal cases and all those things. Similarly, in a bike sharing startup in China. So majority of the, as I see, you know, thing is that important is that the diligence also has a softer side of it. So when I'll give you my own example, we had done a diligence for a startup or VC fund. And where investor was putting in 3 crores of an investment. That was the first transaction which we were doing for that particular VC fund. And we found out a fraud of 30% of the top line. They had shown certain bills as these are deliverables to the clients. And we figured out that they had not paid any GST on that. So, you know, a reason was why would you have not pay a GST on 1.2, 1.5 crores, which was 30% of our revenue. And then figured out that it was just an invoice which they had booked. We did some inquiries to figure out whether that particular customer was genuine or not. We found out that there was no place of business for them, actual genuine business, place of business. Then we figured out that the kind of business they were into and the kind of invoices which they had, it did not go hand in hand. That was the first time when we saw the invoice, we found out it was a cement marketing company, a marketing company giving a business to this particular entity for a brand of cement. And this particular business does not make any sense to us. Though there was an invoice, everything was proper, but still we somehow had a hunch that, you know, this is something looking very fishy because this kind of a customer would not want such kind of service from our client or the target. And we saw that there was surely something wrong. That is when we dig deeper into it and we found out that there was a fraud and they were just trying to bump up the revenue and all. And then finally, the investor walked out. They did not put the money. They did not invest in that particular company. So, yeah, so majority of the, you know, the cases, or you could say the reason for not investing or not going at the investor is related to, regulatory issues or fraud issues or the integrity of the promoters. All those things becomes issue, you know, that becomes a problem. So, yeah, that's about this. So this is also about ask me.com again, an e-commerce company and everything. which was there, they did not work out as they should be. Weak technology, basically their technology team was very, very weak. They did not have people, strong people in their technology team who could support the growth which would be required in the digital e-commerce companies and all. So, you know, you can hide a lot of things, so people say a lot of things which are there would be hidden in the financial statements, but there are many things which is there which are outside of the financial statements also, on the software aspects which needs to be seen, whether you have the capable team enough or not to run the show or grow the story from where you are. If people, when they are not doing good, people make a lot of acquisition also to just show that there is a jump in the revenue. So whenever there are a lot of acquisition or a company makes a lot of acquisitions as well, now it is a point of concern, because they would be doing such kind of acquisition at a higher growth price, higher acquisition price, obviously to either they want to grow more or they are want to try something which is hiding in their financial statement. So, you know, take the example of ILFS acquiring Meta's infrastructure. So Meta's infrastructure was a part of Satyam Group. They were doing all this kind of deals to hide something in their financial statement, right? Or similar case with ILFS as well. So, you know, a lot of time acquisitions are there which are happening more for show away or to distance itself from any problems which are there in the financial statement. So yeah, so that's about it on financial diligence. I'm happy to answer any questions which you guys have. I have something, so this is our company called Cumulative Ventures. We are a 8-member team now, 30 years of experience. We have offices in Mumbai, Delhi, Ahmedabad, Dubai. This is the kind of, just I'm taking a few minutes. These are the kind of services we offer. And yeah, any questions you guys have? Anyone? Happy to answer now. Any questions you guys have? Hello?
Yes, sir. I don't find any questions in the chat box.
Okay. Okay, and no questions, then let me know. Anything you want to understand, you know, any team member or any person wants to understand?
Sir, I have received hello.
Yeah.
So I have received one question from CA Unmesh Hivekarji. He's asking whether we can get a list of angel investor for startups.
Acha. Okay. So there are a lot of angel networks which are there. If you go through their website, so Mumbai Angel Network is there, Indian Angel Network is there, Venture Catalyst is there, Let's Venture is there. A lot of angel network kind of a structure they have. And they sometimes, like I remember, they give a list of all the members which are there on their platform. Those members are basically the angel investors. There is a company called AngelList where there are a lot of angel investors who participate to invest in the opportunities. So there also probably in the members section, you can find a lot of names who invest in these startup companies. How to connect with them for investment. So you can, these are all open platforms. You can write to them where they have given their email IDs, whom to connect and everything. You can write to any people on the members and they would respond. Though it is very difficult if you write an email and to respond. Normally you need some common connection or common, some common network or people who would know them, who would introduce you to them and they would reply. Because what happens is all this investor network and everything, they receive around 100 odd proposals of startup investment every month. So it's very difficult to get their attention. But if you go with some reference or some introduction, then it helps. Sharing ideas, yeah, it is very safe, because just sharing an idea does not make them, they will be able to run their business. Their idea is not to run the business. They themselves want to just invest, right? Otherwise, Swiggy would have been run by VC funds, or Zomato or Ola would have been run by a VC fund or the investors themselves, right? It has not happened that way. The startups, ideas are there, you share with them, they would invest. They are in the business of investing, not in running the business.
Members, anybody else has any query or just want to have direct interaction with our speaker?
Do the work on revenue sharing. No, so they take an equity stake in the company. So it is not a revenue sharing. It's they would take an equity stake in your company.
Okay, so that's a thank you note for you, sir, from our CA Unmesh Narvekar, sir.
Sure.
So here we thank you, sir, for sharing the wealth of your experience and knowledge in the area of due diligence and making us understand the basic difference between an audit and due diligence, with having a scope of work and checklist for ourselves. To give away formal vote of thanks, I request a dynamic past convener, secretary and managing committee member of our Vasai branch, CA Amit Agarwal, sir. Amit, sir. Amit, sir.
Amit ji, awaaz nahi aa rahi aapki.
Abhi aa rahi hai, Ritu madam.
हाँ, पर बहुत धीरे आ रही है सर.
एक सेकंड है. थैंक यू शीतल फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी. फर्स्टली आई वुड लाइक टू बिगिन बाय सेइंग दैट द एंटायर पीपीटी विद मिनट डिटेल माइन्यूट डिटेल विल इन डेप्थ हेल्प आवर मेंबर्स टू शार्पन देयर स्किल्स सेट इन ऑल इमर्जिंग एरियाज ऑफ प्रोफेशनल रेलेवेंस बाय वे ऑफ टेक्निकल VCM. आई प्लीज टू नोट दैट एक्सप्लेनेशन विद प्रैक्टिकल एग्जाम्पल ऑन ईच स्लाइड with in-depth explanation is explanatory. I am sure that this session will be immense help to the members and other interested their invaluable guidance and support in giving final sharpened will go a long way in helping the members understand the fundamental concepts of due diligence and sharpen their skill sets in these areas. Thank you for knowledgeable and best session and taking time out for enriching all with your experience. And I special thanks to our convener and deputy convener for keeping on this important topic webinar. Thank you, madam.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Now I would request our convener, madam, C. Ritu Agarwal ji, to please present a token of thanks to our speaker.
We thank you, sir, for this wonderful presentation. And we have made a contribution of ₹500 in your name to CABF. So we would like to present this receipt to you as a token of gratitude.
Thank you.
Sir, I'll just email this receipt to you.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for taking out time for giving us lecture on this important topic.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Kishore, you may end.